And how does it work? I just...
The big green button, press once to see the goals.
Right, there we go. Wow, look at this. So I've already told you how to do that. Press this. I've already said here's the agenda, lay to order, summary judgment and argument. There'll be a poll. Basically, then we do fact and expert witness testimony. That's the second part. Then the legal argument as they argue over what's going on. And then we hit another poll. So this is where you get to opine as to how you think it should go. And then finally, our judge, Judge Beeler, will do a decision and commentary. And we'll take questions at that time, too, from the audience, assuming we haven't lost all this time. Here's the medical center. We've been there, haven't we? Okay, here's the staff. And so anyway, so we basically have a thing where they've stolen the stuff, and then one person convinces the phone company to issue a new phone with Dr. Feelgood's number. Anybody go to the cryptographer's part of the thing tonight? Did you notice how easy it appears to be to do that? They tested against 5 carriers. They had no problem cloning a phone. She logs into blood services. She exploits a vulnerability to install ransomware, and she encrypts the entire test results database. This is not good. So, because if they can't tell people the results of blood tests and stuff, people might die. So they pay the $500,000 in unmarked bitcoins to get the stuff back. But the evildoer, being an evildoer, notices that there's interesting things in the database. So she sells this to a magazine called The National Questioner, all right? And they publish an article using the contents. And one of the articles they publish is about a guy, M.A. Titan, who has revealed that he has a dire medical condition. Now, he's been essentially trying to negotiate a big merger, changes to the company and so forth. And when his medical condition comes out, values plunge. So he's lost a lot of money. He's rich. So he sues Healing R Us, who's not a patient. He sues the phone company, and he sues We Select Blood Services. And so here we find ourselves in the Moscone West Court West House. And we have with us a real judge, U.S. Magistrate Judge. She's in San Francisco, Laurel Beeler. We have Lisa Angelo, who is a lawyer, who's hiding over here, right here. And Lauren Topelsohn, and real practicing attorneys. We have Julie Lewis, who's going to be an expert witness, who's kind of in the technical business. And we have me, who's playing the VP of Information Services and the Greek chorus. At the moment, I'm clearly in the role of the Greek chorus. We also have all these other people, the counsel for Healing R Us, the counsel for the phone company, the counsel for the defendants, We Mop by Night Custodial Service, the counsel for the National Questioner, because remember how I said he sued everybody? And because he's rich. And the counsel for the defendants, Paul Fabrini and Cassie Hartley, who were the criminal people. And of course, there are criminal charges pending for them, but that's in a separate trial altogether. Someone's supposed to fix this. There are cross claims. Everybody's suing everybody. Nothing is severed. What that means is the judge has not allowed anyone to go any separate child. They want to hear everything together, right? And all claims are being adjudicated, which we're doing. But our play, what we're focusing on, is two parties, Titan versus We Suck Blood Services. And we've started. You're up.
All right. Counsel, you're prepared to make a brief argument in support of your issues of law?
Yes, Your Honor, but first we're going to...
Okay, so you want to put in the stipulated facts, right? Because we're not only hearing on what the claims are that are going to go forward, and then we're going to hear some testimony because I've already issued my tentative ruling that we're likely to go forward. So the lawyers have reached a stipulation about certain facts, and you're welcome to read them into the record now.
Thank you, Your Honor. With regard to the medical center, we've stipulated that the medical center is using 2-factor authentication and password protect. The medical center kept the password, a URL to the lab's web portal, and instructions on a post-it note. The doctor's cell phone number is on her business cards throughout the medical center. The medical center pays for the cell phone service plan for all of the doctors. With regard to Paul and Casey, Paul is employed by We Mop at Night, a custodial service. Paul steals the post-it note, the doctor's business card, and a medical center phone bill. Casey and the doctor announced she is taking a cruise. Paul is buying a phone bought a phone from the same carrier, drove a car over the phone, and damaged the center.
All right, those stipulated facts will be considered as evidence. Are you ready to proceed with your arguments?
Yes, Your Honor.
All right. You may proceed.
The defendant's motion for summary judgment is proper and should be granted because the plaintiff does not have standing to bring its claim under the California Consumer Privacy Act of 2018, also known as CCPA. The CCPA is a carve-out or a safe harbor for certain types of businesses that handle personal health information and are governed under HIPAA. This case is about a data breach of plaintiff's personal health information, and it's been stipulated that the lab is a business associate under HIPAA. Therefore, the lab falls under the safe harbor, and CCPA does not apply to this case.
All right. Counsel, did you want to confer for a moment?
Our attorneys are confused for a moment.
The only issue is, were you going to make any further argument on the HIPAA issues? And if you want to reserve your time and respond to your arguments, that's fine with me.
There is also not a private right of action under HIPAA.
Okay, all right. All right, thank you. Thank you for your argument. So, interesting issues about whether the California regulatory scheme and the interaction with the federal HIPAA requirements. Counsel, what is your view on the defendant's summary judgment motion, the lab's summary judgment motion?
Laurel and Topelsohn, attorney for the plaintiff. The defendant has made clear they're moving to dismiss what they conceive are two of our counts. One is under the California Privacy Act, one is under HIPAA. With respect to the California Privacy Act, we have there is a safe harbor provision. Business associates, medical professionals who are governed by HIPAA. That is true. Sorry. Governed by HIPAA. But there's in the same statute, Section B, however, refers to another carve-out. And in the first part, A, refers to personal information of patients only, PHI. And again, it covers covered entities and healthcare providers. The B part of that section refers to patient information, not PHI, but patient information. And in B, it says there is a safe harbor, again, just for patient information, but it only refers to providers or covered entities. It does not refer to business associates. So Plaintiff's position is that because the lab collects both PHI and personal information, that the second portion, they collected from my clients as well, and we were damaged as a result, so it's not protected to the extent it has my client's personal information. The carve-out doesn't apply.
All right, what's your view on the HIPAA argument?
On the HIPAA argument, the defense counsel has misconstrued our argument. We have not stated a separate cause of action under HIPAA. We have instead set asserting a negligence claim. We're using HIPAA standards as a way of evidencing the standards of negligence, but not for a separate cause of action.
Got it. So it's the rule that you're defining that establishes the duty that was breached as part of your negligence claim. I understand the argument. All right. Hoyt, are we going to run the poll next? I think we're running the poll.
That's what we're trying to do.
And that's what I'm...
And this is exactly what I was afraid of. Nothing's working.
We could always do a show of hands.
So we'll yeah.
Because it's just interesting to think, and then on the ideas, we're gonna have a trial, so you kind of know what the outcome's gonna be up here. But we're interested in your thoughts. So Hoyt, why don't you at least do that? We could do the poll old school style by just
actually
reading
it. Well, I'm trying to, but again, technical expertise. Tell me how I'm supposed to trigger a freaking poll.
Let's do it the old-fashioned way.
Yeah, the old-fashioned way. So by show of hands, who thinks the California Consumer Protection Act specifically? Let's just give one more chance, but I think we just do show of hands. Who thinks that the California Consumer Protection Act specifically prohibits this lawsuit? Raise your hand if you think that's correct. And there's actually no law that's on point, so there's no incorrect answer. There's no case that's addressed the issue squarely, as I understand it. So does anyone have a view, yes, that it should prohibit the lawsuit? Okay? What's that?
Nine votes so far.
So yeah, okay, we're just not seeing the poll. So excellent, thank you, that's awesome. So people are voting. Okay, so that, and so as to B, what's the total on B?
For a no, 23 votes.
All right, you guys are good Californians because Californians have a really strong protective instinct towards consumers on all kinds of landscapes. So now I think I'm just supposed to rule, so I'll rule because we're going to have a trial so you can guess what the outcome is going to be. I'm going to let the claim go forward. This is a bench trial. I don't know what kind of crazy lawyers would agree to a bench trial before any judge. They waived it. They removed the case from, thanks to diversity of citizenship, they removed the case to federal court.
If you want to ask
and they got stuck with not complying with the removal requirements for a jury demand. The CCPA claim is going forward. The defense motion to for summary judgment on the negligence claim is denied because HIPAA is the predicate duty that defines the standard of care for the negligence case. All right, then. So that's the court's ruling. And counsel, are you prepared to call your first witness?
For We Suck Blood Lab Services.
All right, just for efficiency's sake, the witness has already been sworn in seconds. So quickly you didn't even see it. Counsel, you may proceed with your examination.
Thank you, Your Honor. Mr. Kesterson, what do you do?
I'm essentially in charge of everything that goes on technically, information systems at We Suck Blood Services.
And what does We Suck Blood Lab Services do?
Well, We Suck Blood Services basically does blood testing, all kinds of fluid testing.
We have clients which are medical centers, we have clients which are doctor's offices, we have clients which are hospitals, and we have walk-in clients.
And are you familiar with Healing RS Medical Center?
Yes, they're one of our clients.
Can you describe the business interactions between the lab and Healing our Healing our?
Yes, healing or us, yes. Basically, twice a day, we send their services over to collect samples that center will have collected from their patients. We bring it back to the lab. Our people perform the tests that are requested. The tests get posted into a testing results database, and the results that are in that database are accessible to our clients and only our clients. Who can reach into the system and say, I want to see the test results for patient X or patient Y.
Can you provide a little bit more detail about how the medical center accesses the lab records?
We basically have a web interface. You access it across the internet. You, as whoever the client is, will authenticate themselves by providing their ID, their password, and since we use two-factor authentication, then effectively we challenge them with the second factor.
Are there other options available other than, strike that, are there other options available for the second factor?
Well, we offer many options for second factor. We basically support pretty much all the real popular ones, the authentication applications, Google, and we support SMS over across the regular phone.
How did the lab decide to offer these particular options as a second factor?
They're the popular ones in the industry.
Does the lab have a security expert?
We have a staff of people who do security.
Would the security expert have weighed in on these decisions?
Well, certainly I did not make the decisions about what the options would be. The security staff said, we're going to do two-factor, and this is what we're going to offer.
Do you or does the lab usually consult a security expert to make decisions about information security?
That's pretty much the only people we consult with.
Do you know what percentage of your clients choose SMS as a second factor?
SMS is very popular. It's very popular because your investment is pretty much a phone, which you've already made an investment in. It doesn't cost you anything more than texting services, and texting services effectively are free or included in the contract. So 20, 30, 40% of our people will use SMS for texting.
And why didn't the lab just use the password?
Well, it's pretty much a standard in the industry. If you're going to have anything that's sensitive in nature like PII, you need to have strong authentication and two-factor using both something you know and something you have. Is essentially the industry practice.
Okay, and switching gears a little bit back to the password, are there particular requirements for the passwords that your clients create?
Well, because we handle walk-ins and because people pay us with credit cards, because we're a fairly big company and generate a lot of credit card traffic, we conform to the PCI, Payment Card Industry's data security standard, and we get assessed once a year, and we're actually supposed to follow the requirements that are set up in the data security standard, and it has very specific requirements for passwords.
What's your understanding of the requirements for passwords?
The requirements are the passwords have to be complex, which means it just can't be letters, it just can't be numbers. It has to be a mixture of upper and lower case, numbers and special characters. It has to be a minimum length of 8, and you're required to change whatever you've chosen for a password every 90 days.
You just mentioned that you are audited annually. Have you ever not passed an audit?
No, we passed every PCI audit.
And Mr. Kesterson, are you familiar with Dr. Alicia Feelgood?
She is an employee of one of our clients.
And is Dr. Feelgood an employee of the lab?
No, of our clients.
Okay. And how does Dr. Feelgood work with the lab?
Basically, she doesn't do it very often, it's my understanding, but she's able to access records of patients who are healing or us.
Objection.
What's the ground for the objection? Foundation?
No, yes.
All right, objection is sustained. Counsel, you may lay foundation if you can. The basis of his knowledge.
Mr. Kesterson, how are you familiar with Dr. Feelgood?
I'm familiar with her for two reasons. Number one, because of this case. Okay, so I understand this is how it's supposed to be done. Normally, I would not know who is employed at each of our clients, okay? But because of the particulars of this case, she's been identified as the person whose credentials were in fact stolen.
And did you hear testimony from Dr. Feelgood?
Yes.
Yes. And do you remember how Dr. Feelgood accesses the lab's portal?
Well, she accesses it as any client would access it, which means she would connect across the internet via web browser. To our web pages. She would enter in her unique ID identifying her. She would enter in her password. Our system would then send a value to whatever her second factor is, and then that value would get kicked back as part of the authentication process. And since she uses SMS tokens, that would be a number that's displayed on her phone, and she would enter that number in. We would recognize that as the number that we had sent to the phone that supposedly belongs to her, mm-hmm. And we would say, okay, second factor authentication is complete, let's move forward.
Did the lab issue Dr. Feelgood's password?
Yes, we do, yes.
No, excuse me,
let's be clear about this.
Let me rephrase the question.
Yeah.
Did the lab issue a password to Dr. Feelgood?
No, she generates it herself.
And is there any requirement for how she generates that password?
We don't care as long as she meets the rules. The rules of upper or lower case. A password has to contain upper and lower case numbers and special characters.
Okay. Are those the rules you referenced earlier?
Yes.
With the PCI?
Yes. We basically, if we're going to put it, since we had to put a password system in for PCI, we made it apply to everyone.
And are you familiar with an individual named Cassie Hartley?
I don't know the individual, but since that's the person who's been identified by law enforcement as the person who did a ransomware attack, I am somewhat familiar.
Okay, and from testimony, from Cassie's testimony, do you know anything about how she hacked into the database?
I only know that she basically purloined by some method both the password and that she managed to somehow copy the second factor device.
Counsel, I just want to remind you of the extremely draconian trial limits that I've set of 6 minutes per side, per witness. So just to get that over all time. What a terrible judge.
One more question, if I may, Your Honor.
Yeah, of course.
Mr. Kesterson, would it have been possible for Cassie to access the database without the doctor's password?
Objection. Calls for speculation.
I'll overrule the objection, given the witness's obvious expertise in the IT systems.
Yeah, the only people who can access the database are clients, okay? And therefore, she had to masquerade as a client.
No further questions.
All right, cross-examination?
Sure. I just want to straighten out. Sorry, Mr. Kesterson. I know you represent, you're the information security officer, the information officer of the lab, correct?
We suck blood services. We have an information security officer. I am not that person.
You're the information.
He works for me.
He works for you. So you're the chief. You're at the very top in terms of the VP of information security.
No, I am VP of information systems. And security is a part of it.
Okay, and you said you're in charge, actually, you testified that you're in charge of everything that we do related to our systems.
In terms of all the computer services we offer, yes.
So that means you help establish policies.
Yes.
You implement them.
My people implement them.
Right, and you ensure they're followed?
My people ensure they're followed.
Okay, and but those people ensure they're followed and they report to you that they are being followed, correct?
Yes, I take their word for it.
Right, before you actually testified that you've never passed a PCI, that you've never failed a PCI audit, do you recall testifying to that?
Yes.
You also testified that you use 8 characters in your passwords.
Yes.
I thought you said
a minimum of 8.
A minimum of 8,
yeah.
And that's compliant?
That's compliant to PCI.
All right, and you implemented PCI standards across the board for all your systems, isn't that correct?
Yes, if you're gonna do an authentication system, it's just best to have it consistent for everyone.
And so that same authentication system is what you use for your lab test work, right?
Yes.
And in terms of the testing that your lab does, what kind of tests do they include?
You mean what kind of testing do we do?
Yes.
Blood, urine, semen, practically anything liquid and gross.
So pretty personal stuff, right?
Yes, right.
All right. You're paid for those tests to do that testing, correct?
Well, I don't, but someone does.
Well, the lab, your company, the lab, is paid to do that testing.
Yes.
And it's also paid to collect the tests,
that
you
is
said
true.
So, and to process them.
Yes.
It's also paid to maintain the data of the results of those tests?
Yes.
And you said that you actually not only have a database, but you have a web portal that you provide to your clients for access to that database.
That's correct.
And that's according to a subscription fee that they pay in addition in order to have a license to enter into to use your services for blood.
No, if they're clients
or for
and
any
we charge
testing.
Them, they're able to get to the stuff we charge them for.
Okay, but is it built into your price structure?
Yes, obviously.
So it's something it's something the lab is paid for.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. So let's talk about SMS. Recently, it was referred to your expertise in the area. You consulted with a security advisor in order to determine that you should be using SMS as a second factor authentication?
Our security staff basically, in terms of trying to follow the level of security that's prevalent in our industry, wanted to do two-factor authentication, and they said this is what we should do, and let's do it.
They said this is what we should do in terms of SMS. I'm really looking at the SMS factor right now.
Actually, what they said to me is let's do two-factor authentication. I was not aware of any of the details.
All right, but the lab has employed as a second factor SMS.
The lab, we select blood services, has security staff who basically have implemented two-factor authentication, and apparently one of the options of doing two-factor authentication is SMS, and we offer that as an option to our clients.
And you offer that as an option to your clients. Do you offer that, do you use two-factor authentication, including an SMS option when people are paying by credit card?
Anyone who logs into our system to retrieve results, okay, basically does two-factor authentication. If anyone logs into our system to access their account because they're playing with credit cards and stuff, anyone who logs into our system for anything, okay, is going to do two-factor authentication.
And SMS is an option for any reason to log into your database.
Any person who's come into a contract with us for access to our system picks how they want to do two-factor authentication.
But that's not the question. The question is that you offer SMS as an option across the board for any resources.
Any person may choose to use SMS, yes.
Okay. So now you testify that you are PCI compliant. And wasn't it the auditor who required the lab to employ two-factor authentication?
Well, two-factor authentication for in terms of the PCI services is only required for access to the financial systems. They don't require it for access to any place else.
Yes, but you've applied it across the board.
Yes, but not because of PCI.
You made a decision to use that standard across the board, isn't that correct?
We made a decision that it is simpler to use one system for everyone than multiple systems.
So the only reason you have two factors when people are accessing PHI is because you wanted to be PCI compliant so that you could accept credit card payments.
The only reason that we have two-factor is that we implemented it to meet PCI, and we chose to implement it for everyone else.
Right, because it was easier to have one standard. That's what you testified to.
It was easier to have one implementation, yes.
Okay.
And just so you know, we probably have 16 minutes left in our overall. It's a dense presentation for the short amount of time we have. Yes.
All right. So your PCI information is encrypted, I'd assume, correct?
Yes, because we're required to encrypt it.
Right, but your PHI information is not encrypted.
PCI could care anything about test data.
That's not the question. Your PHI, your patient information, which arguably is some of the most sensitive data that we've just described.
Well, that is an argument, yes.
Involving all of their medical tests, yes. Correct? Everything that they may not want to even share with their family, and it's not encrypted, isn't that correct?
It's not.
Okay. Now, the data breach. You found out that I know you were busy paying a ransom for the exfiltrated data.
No, we were paying a ransom for the locked data.
Sorry, for the locked data. In fact, that's correct. Thank you for correcting me, because you actually didn't detect that data had been exfiltrated until later down the line. Isn't that true?
That's true.
Several days later, as a matter of fact.
Yes.
It was only after an internal inquiry required by the FBI. Isn't that true?
Well, sort of, maybe, yes.
So the intrusion, so not only was the intrusion also wasn't detected.
Well, the intrusion was pretty well detected when nothing worked.
Right, but you didn't know that somebody had broken into the system until after the fact.
Right, we didn't know someone had broken into their system until nothing worked, and they said it won't work until you give us half.
And you didn't know that anybody had stolen anything until you got that same demand.
Ransomware, we didn't think of breach at all. We thought merely of ransomware.
So that went undetected altogether.
Yes, it is.
Okay. And the medical center, how many clients does it have? Thousands, I assume.
The medical center?
The lab. It has thousands of clients?
Thousands of clients.
And those hospitals, doctors, as big as you can imagine?
Yes, yes.
And each of those hospitals and doctors and practices have hundreds of patients?
Yes.
And isn't it true that there was over 3.6 million patient records exposed as a result of this breach?
That might be true, yes.
I have no further questions.
All right. We are not allowing redirect because of the time constraints. You all have probably 2 minutes each. Were you prepared to call your next witness?
Yes.
The plaintiff calls its expert witness.
Right. Just to expedite things, my expert's an expert in everything.
and we've already accepted her as an expert, so there will be no objections to her expertise. So go right to the facts.
Not going
to
lay out any of that. Do you have a personal opinion, or actually, an expert opinion about the use of SMS as a second factor authentication?
Well, given recent time, technology always changes. Like, remember firewalls, intrusion detection, intrusion protection, and all these other technologies. It's known that SMS is not a safe method for two-level authentication. In fact, the NIST...
It's vulnerable.
Has indicated that it's vulnerable because there's also hacking tools that can intercept SMS, you know, SIM card swapping or cloning that we, you know, is out there with a lot of cryptocurrency
traders
right now.
You just referred to SIM swapping. Is that what occurred here?
That's what incurred here. Some may say SIM cloning. I call it SIM swapping, where the phone company was basically duped.
Are you as a practice, do you propose alternatives to SMS?
Yeah, there's a lot of different, so especially in medical right now. So if you look at our local area here, you've got Stanford, which has, they use Improvata for their two-level authentication system.
What kind of system is that?
Is
that called an OTT system? It's an application?
Well, OTT is on the phone, so it's part of that overall system, but you can also load it on desktops and laptops, and it uses push tokens or fingerprints or soft tokens, hard tokens. So there's a lot of other things integrated.
You said that it can be used on a mobile device. So is it in some ways as efficient or as easy to use as an SMS system?
Yes, it is.
So there's
Way more secure.
Way more secure.
And so Google Authenticator is another one. But when you look at just the healthcare industry, you know, they're Improvata. You know, as I mentioned, is being used by Stanford. Actually, by Sutter here locally and Duo Mobile.
Council, I hate
Stanford.
To do this to you, but we have 12 minutes overall, including for our end of the session polling. So if you could see if you could wrap it up.
Right. So you read the report.
We've got to do the whole thing in 12 minutes.
All right. You read the report of the forensic report regarding the break-in. And one of the things that was reported in the expert report was that the exploiters used a function never previously used. Is there a way that they could have been prevented?
Yeah, I mean, when they used the doctor's, basically the doctor had a yellow sticky. So number one, not having yellow stickies laying on the desk with usernames and passwords, you know, is low-hanging fruit. Specifically the lab, they should have been doing application testing or penetration testing of that specific system. There shouldn't have been, you shouldn't allow one person with a login at one medical institution to log in and have access to everything across the board, and to be, you know, that would have prevented that ability to do a SQL injection.
So you're talking about siloing the information?
Yeah, with proper access controls and partitioning of the database.
And the fact that they stole the password and got the carrier to clone the SIM, Was there no way to prevent that break-in? Was there another way to detect that this was not the actual user, was not Dr. Feelgood?
Yeah, I mean, you can put alerts to the phone company, and you hope that the techs making $15 to $20 an hour are reading those alerts of extra codes that need to go in. There's also, you know, it was smashed, so they never really authenticated with that it was Dr. Feelgood through a photo ID.
How about an IP authenticator?
Yeah, and also, you know, there's a lot of software systems that do authenticate by IP address as well. So if a user logs in from a different system than they are usually logging in from, it'll alert and send a code as well.
So in your expert opinion, this could have been completely prevented.
There could have been a lot of extra security measures put into place, including behavioral analytics software at the lab to show that the system was being used in a way that historically that it hasn't. So looking at the pattern recognition of that as well.
Okay. No further questions.
Thank you, counsel. Counselor, so your cross-examination, we'll do 3 minutes because I need to talk with my law clerks about what the heck I'm going to do here. We have 10 minutes overall left, 9 minutes overall left, so we've still got to engage with them. So you may proceed.
In your expert opinion, would you agree that a password written on a sticky note is not a secure password?
That's correct. That is not secure.
Would you also agree that it wouldn't matter how many numbers or special characters were in that password on a sticky note?
That's correct. That password would have been compromised by being on someone's desk.
And it wouldn't matter how frequently you changed the password if you kept writing it on a sticky note?
That's correct.
All right, no further questions.
All right, thank you. All right, so that was the quickest trial ever. The court has taken, this is a piece of the trial that you've seen, the court is taking the matter under submission. It's a bench trial. I am retreating into chambers to talk with my law clerks, and that's you. Hoyt's going to run a poll.
So you guys can vote on the new poll. While I talk to you, my law clerks, about what you think the correct answers are. This is not what I think is the correct answer. It's what you think is the correct answer, because as any good judge does, I'm going to rely on your thoughts about the key issues in the lawsuit. And mostly, what are your thoughts? I mean, we have different people who are, the issue really is negligence. Every lawsuit is a tort. Even a breach of contract is a tort. It's a whose job is it? What's their responsibility? Where should the burden be apportioned? What are your views on it? You guys can come up to the mic and speak. Come on, you're lawyers. You like to talk, right?
We can call on people if we don't have
all. Exactly. Someone must have an opinion, right? So you have a doctor who leaves her password on the computer, and the custodial staff who finds it, and the happens to be the genius hacker girlfriend who exploits the system functionality, elevates her administrative privileges, and gets all the data and sells it. Who's responsible? And all liable. Okay, so Hoyt's going to do the poll. What are your thoughts?
So
clerk one. I'm so lucky to have so many clerks.
I'm not a lawyer, but my mom's a lawyer.
Okay.
So subject that counts.
I'm lawyer by affiliation. Person. Yeah.
But my first question would be, is there any basis to relying on a mobile device at all as being secure? Because we're talking about Google, we're talking about all these applications.
So that's the SMS two-factor authentication, and is that a good security measure? Yeah, dual-factor authentication.
But the question is, a mobile device, okay, whether it's...
Excuse me. No questions. Opine, please.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so you're concerned, so
opine. How do you think the ruling should be?
A mobile device can be rooted or jailbroken. And if that happens, then any second factor that's running on the mobile device is suspect. It doesn't matter
opine,
SMS.
Please.
Well, he said it doesn't. He basically says it's a disqualifier. So if you allow it, then that's a problem for you from a liability perspective.
Right.
Okay, so that's the point there. Another point, yes, point.
I would say that we missed out on some of the SQL injection and bits like that, where negligence of the
lab.
The SMS bit, it may have been perfectly adequate a year ago, but if things have changed in the last year, then his security needs to be stepped up. To me, the real issue was the lab.
Does anyone know what the polling results are, by the way? Because we should hear what those are. Okay, observation.
So, We Suck Blood failed in their duty of care. I don't know how Health R Us is responsible. Clearly, the phone company also failed their duty of care to appropriately.
What about the doctor by posting her, vicarious liability?
The doctor clearly is culpable.
And is there a vicarious theory of liability against the employer?
I'm not a lawyer. I don't even know what that means.
All right. So, but who do you think, also, what do you guys think about who's most responsible? These crazy people consented to a bench trial, and I have to apportion.
Over objection.
kidding. Oh, I'm just kidding. We're in conference. You can't hear me. Over objection, right?
So I definitely think this, starts from the doctor being negligent, right? The human element there didn't know, there's this not enough education there, but again, the using phone company as a second factor authentication, while it is assuming that it has become a well-known fact in the industry, it is still being used as a second factor auth by the We Suck Blood company. I think that would make them liable. If the law prohibits, if that they are, so, because if they are PCI compliant, but what about what to allow as a second factor auth? Is that in the guidelines? If it is, then they are, then it becomes the case. If they are allowed to use it, then they're okay.
So you're saying that what the rules say is okay matters when you're defining the duty of care.
Okay, so I look at it differently. I'm an engineer. I would say We Suck Blood attempted...
It would not be on my jury then. Just kidding.
Hey, but I got a daughter who's a lawyer. Does that count? No. We Suck Blood attempted to take due diligence, show due care, in that they followed an industry standard. The industry standard allowed them to use two-factor with SMS, otherwise they would have failed it. And therefore, in attempting to show blah, 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 maybe not them. The person with the list sticky note, terribly stupid, incredibly stupid, but they did take due care in that it was probably behind a locked door, in a controlled area behind multiple locked doors with probable restricted access, and in theory they could not have anticipated that the criminals would commit a crime.
Excellent. So, that's kind so of you're where saying an intervening factor is the criminal activity in a private space.
And also the fact that the standard was still valid at the time the crime occurred.
Okay, we have another observation here, another law clerk to the rescue.
So I think the issue of the doctor writing her password on a sticky note is really a red herring. Because when you have two-factor authentication, then having the password available is not going to let you get on the system. There has to be another form factor that will then give you the permission. So somebody was talking about, well, what happens when you jailbreak the systems and all those kind of things. I think what the law imposes on you is to be able to show, to provide reasonable care. We cannot be able to address for every single possible way that those systems can be broken. Now, the mere fact that you have two form factor authentication, in my views, means that you've even gone beyond what is normally expected of people. So I will say that, you know, the company has taken all necessary and reasonable precautions.
Okay, I'm going to exercise my rights that this witness cannot be on my jury.
Good, thank you. Excellent observation, so thank you. I think we have time for a last comment, and then we'll see what the poll tells us, and then I'll issue my decision.
If we ever do, yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Someone can tell me what the poll says if they can read it on their phone.
I'm also not a lawyer, and I'm an engineer, but I think in this case, the phone company should be liable because they did not perform the correct validation when issuing a new SIM card to this person. And regardless of all the other ways that the We Suck Blood did not secure their data, that was not part of this attack vector.
Okay. All right. So 1 minute left. Someone tell me what the poll says.
Votes for yes, that all defendants are liable. No liability, one vote. Some, not all liable, 16 votes.
Okay. All right. Well, and...
Thank you for that.
I'm going to take the matter under submission and issue my ruling shortly. No, I mean, it's interesting because of the issues of comparative fault and also the damages. He's asking for an enormous amount of damages. We'll have a second phase, a damages phase to put in the damages amount. I think the primary liability is assigned to the lab, and I will issue a more concrete ruling with my percentages shortly. Thank you very much, Your Honor. All right, and that's that concludes today's trial. Thank you all for being here. Hoyt, do you want any last words?
Get the hell out of here. if you have any questions, we can answer them in the hallway.
So if you want to talk with us, you're welcome to talk with us. Yeah.
It's a password.
Thanks, you guys, for doing a great job in a ridiculously short amount of time.